नमस्ते ते कने दशहरे दिया मतिया मतिया मुबारका। टुडे वी ऑल हैव गैदर्ड टुगेदर टू सेलिब्रेट द एक्सेशन ऑफ जम्मू एंड कश्मीर टू इंडिया बाय महाराजा हरि सिंह जी। इट वाज साइंड ऑन 26 अक्टूबर 1947। दिस डे गेव अस आवर आइडेंटिटी एज इंडियंस फॉर विच वी आर ग्रेटफुल टू महाराजा हरि सिंह जी। टुडे वी हैव सेवरल स्पीकर्स विद अस। जस्ट टू क्विकली इंट्रोड्यूस आवर एस्टीम्ड स्पीकर्स, वी हैव हिस्टोरियन and author Harbhajan Singh Sambhyalji, as well as Arif Azakia Bhai, who is a human rights activist from Pakistan, currently living in London. I would now like to bring in Krishna Panditji to introduce himself. He's the president of Dev Samaj, Dogra Samaj Trust in Mumbai.
Namaste, sare dasere diyan matiyan matiyan badhaiyan. और निके नमस्ते ते बड़े चरमंदरा। साड़ा डोगरा समाज ट्रस्ट मुंबई में पिछले 10 साल से काम कर रही है और वो डिफरेंट डिफरेंट जगह पर काम कर रही है। जैसे कोई जम्मू से कोई पेशेंट आता है उसकी मदद करना, जम्मू से कोई स्टूडेंट आता है उसकी मदद करना, और जब डोगरों का मुंबई के अंदर कुछ भी इश्यूज हो गए वो इश्यूज सॉल्व करना, ये डोगरा समाज का प्रथम कर्तव्य है और वो कर्तव्य हम करते आ रहे हैं। इसी के साथ हम साल में 4 प्रोग्राम करते हैं। एक हम लोहड़ी का प्रोग्राम करते हैं जनवरी महीने में, दूसरा जुलाई महीने में हम कारगिल विजय दिवस मनाते हैं, तीसरा हम अपना एक दिया शहीदों के लिए, और एक आध कार्यक्रम और भी हम लेते रहते हैं। ऐसे साल के हमारे 4-5 कार्यक्रम चलते रहते हैं। इसी तरह हम लोग, ज्यादा टाइम आपका लूंगा नहीं क्योंकि बहुत सारे लोग बोलने वाले हैं, तो इतने ही मेरे बोलकर मैं अपने शब्द को यहीं पे विराम देता हूँ। जय हिंद, जय जम्मू, जय डोगरा।
Thank you. I will quickly also introduce, we have 2 very special guests from Jammu and Kashmir with us. We have Sangeeta Jaitley ji. She's the daughter of Girdhari Lal Dogra. He needs no introduction. He has been the ex-finance minister of Jammu and Kashmir for over 26 years. She's the wife of late Arun Jaitley ji, the finance minister of India. Both of them need no introduction. Thank you so much for being with us today. And our other esteemed guest from Jammu and Kashmir today is Mukesh Rishi ji, who is a Bollywood celebrity and he's made Jammu's name famous all over the world. Thank you for being with us, Mukesh Rishi ji. To take the program further, I would now request Vikrant Gupta to proceed.
Thank you very much. Namaskar, everyone. Good evening to everyone who have joined us from India, and good morning slash good afternoon to everyone who has joined us from London and Europe. So as we all know, today we have joined us, you know, gathered together to talk about the topic, which is accession of Jammu and Kashmir into India. August 1947, India got independence. Jammu and Kashmir was a princely state ruled by Maharaja Hari Singh ji. At that time, Maharaja had decided not to accede either with Pakistan or India. He had his own vision of the future and wanted a standstill agreement with both the countries. October 22, 1947, Pakistan invaded Kashmir Valley, disguised along with tribal invaders. The whole operation was codenamed Operation Gulmarg. This is the time when the whole idea of not joining any of the countries changed, and a lot of series of events happened, which I would really request our esteemed panelist here, Mr. Harbhajan Singh Sambhyalji, to throw some light on it and give us an idea on exactly what happened during that time and what was the course of action which brought us to the day, 26th of October, 1947, when Maharaja Hari Singh ji signed the accession with India and did the grateful thing for all of us to give us the identity, which is now we are all called Indians, and we are very proudly saying that. So Harbhajan sir, I'll come over to you. Please give us some idea on this.
Thank you very much, Vikrant, and thanks for having me again here. Good morning to all the viewers in UK, Europe, also the North America, and good evening to all the viewers in India. My greetings on the twin occasion of Dashera as well as Accession Day, which we are celebrating today. It doesn't matter, it's on 26th, but we have decided to hold this function, this talk, conversation today. I would like to point out two things regarding the accession. The first is regarding Maharaja Hari Singh. He is generally accused of delaying a decision regarding accession. Some people say that he was unable to take a decision. Others attribute motives to him. But few people point out the fact of geography, religion, culture, and all related trade related issues. It is very essential that we recall how this state was built very briefly. That is, it was only the hill states of Jammu and Raja Gulab Singh, by dint of his courage, ambition, and the good fortune of having an excellent general in his army, Zorawar Singh, they combined. Raja Gulab Singh had the vision and he was in a position to support that campaign, and Zorawar Singh launched a campaign into Ladakh. So the first step in the making of this state was that Jammu expanded to include Ladakh within it. The second step was again taken by Zorawar Singh with the support of Raja Gulab Singh, and Baltistan too was incorporated in the kingdom of Jammu. Please keep in mind these distinctions. It was the Jammu kingdom which incorporated Ladakh and then Baltistan. Later, because of the events of Lahore, which there is no need to go into at this point, Kashmir was also handed over to Raja Gulab Singh. And with that, he became the Maharaja of the state of Jammu and Kashmir. So this is how the state of Jammu and Kashmir was built. Maharaja Ranveer Singh, he added to the territories by conquering the feudatory states of Gilgit, Hunza, Nagar, etc. So that was a state which was ruled by Maharaja Hari Singh on the eve of 1947. The instrument of accession required the princely rulers to opt either for India or for Pakistan before 15th of August. The problem with Maharaja Hari Singh was that the environment which had been built within this narrative was such that communal passions were ruling both India and the proposed Pakistan. The state was in a deep trouble for the simple reason that the people of Jammu, majority, they were Hindus. Part of Poonch region, Mirpur region, that was Muslim. Ladakh was Buddhist. Gilgit, Baltistan was Muslim, though Shia. And Kashmir was predominantly Sunni, and yet with a spattering of Kashmiri Pandits. So what would have happened if he had decided one way or another at that point of time? Had he decided to go to India at that point of time, then he would have been extremely unfair to the vast majority of his state, which consisted of Muslims. And then there was the example of Junagadh. Junagadh was a predominantly Muslim, Hindu state ruled by a Muslim ruler. And when he acceded to Pakistan, that was not accepted by India. And a referendum was held. And because of that referendum, Junagadh remained a part of India. So how could any person in his mind accept a principle at one place and reject the same principle at another place? So that was the difficulty of joining with India. Now, joining with Pakistan, that option was fraught with extreme dangers. Ladakh, the Buddhist population, would either have been killed, converted, or driven into Tibet. Punch, again, there would have been bloodshed because Hindus were also there. And in Punch region, the majority was of Muslims. They wanted the accession to take place with Pakistan. Kashmir, again, the Pandits, the Sikhs, and the few Christians who lived there, they too would have been slaughtered as they were slaughtered in the Punjab region after the partition. Or they would have been driven out, lock, stock, and barrel. So this was the situation there. So he decided in his wisdom that the best course is that I offer a standstill agreement to both the countries. We enter into a standstill agreement and then wait till the times when this communal madness that comes to an end. That madness had to end sooner or later. So he wanted to buy time. But the problem was that the instrument of accession did not have a clause of standstill agreement unless the instrument of accession has been signed. Since the instrument of accession at that point of time was not signed in favor of India, therefore, there was no question of India accepting or rejecting the standstill agreement. On the face of it, Pakistan accepted it. When you look back in hindsight, one feels that it accepted it because though it had no sanctity, it wanted to give the message that it is a sympathizer of the Maharaja and his state. So with that in mind, he waited. But unfortunately, in the month of August, things began to change. Here I would like to point out another thing which the historians do not point out and which we also, as a matter of routine, accept that 22nd October is the Black Day. 22nd October is the day when invaders entered into the state. Let me categorically reject this proposition. I'm bold enough to state on the basis of records that the invasion began on 11th of October and it did not begin because the Kabilis attacked Kashmir Valley. It began because the invaders attacked Punch. The first invasion took place from Punch. Punch has a very difficult kind of a history. A vast majority of the population there served in the army. immediately after the Second World War, a large number of soldiers, they had been demobilized. With their demobilization, they had come home. They had been away for almost 4 years. And they had nothing to do here. The British, they used to give money, financial aid to the princely states for developing those areas from which they make recruitment for the British forces. During the war effort, the princes had played a major role, and therefore money was granted to all the princely states according to their strength and according to the need of the region which needed to be developed. J&K state was also given money, but the propaganda of Pakistan among these soldiers was that this money was sent by His Majesty for distribution among the demobilized soldiers. And this money has been withheld by the Maharaja. So that began an upheaval among the demobilized soldiers. Dissatisfaction was there even before 11th of October. Now, may I draw your attention to the fact that a number of times Major General Govardhan Singh has pointed out that when the invasion took place, the army headquarters in Delhi, they heard something that there were places, Sansa and Oven, where some skirmishes were taking place. Some battle was going on. The Indian Army's headquarters had absolutely no idea where these two places were, because the geographical encyclopedia compendium, they tried to look at it and they didn't find any mention of these two places. So they were so ignorant. And why was this so? It was because before this even took place, before the problem of the British exit and independence of India happened in a very haphazard manner, there was a person in charge of liaisoning with the army headquarters in Srinagar, with the state headquarters. This department in New Delhi, that was wound up. With that department having been wound up, there was no way that the Indian Army could have any connect with the state forces, state army, and find out what is happening there. In such a situation, I suggest that let us recalibrate our views regarding the accession. Let us be little kinder to the memory of Maharaja Hari Singh regarding the difficulties he faced acceding to India, and also appreciate the challenge, the problem which the state forces faced. Because in Punch, it had so happened that much of the fighting units, they had been drawn, they had been deputed to Punch area. As a result, Kashmir stood exposed. It stood exposed because it was felt wrongly, as history proved, that the fourth Jack that would be able to defend the borders, because the Pakistani raiders would not be allowed to cross the Kohala Bridge. How that peripety struck that Pulton and the state, and how dearly we paid for it, that is a matter of record and history. So this is the brief introduction to the subject of accession. And I think I'll stop here at the moment, Vikrant.
Yeah, sure. Sir, we have Major Govardhan Singh Jamwalji joining us. So I would like to go towards him and perhaps asking about his experiences, because he's been one of those brave soldiers who have fought during those times in 1947. So I would like to put up to you, Sir Govardhan Sir. First of all, namaskar and thank you for joining us. Sir, I would like to get some points from you on what your experiences have been since October 22, 1947 and up to the accession day. Please do enlighten us.
Thank you very much. It's a nice hearing Harbans ji always giving us the real facts. I will give you two aspects of the accession. One, as far as I know, as a layman, why accession was delayed and why accession was not done before 14th August, as advised by Mountbatten to Maharaja Hari Singh in Kashmir. When he came to Kashmir, I was present in Kashmir that day also. And the second aspect is when the accession took place, how it took place, what happened. Both the things I will try to cover. Now, as far as the accession before 14th August is concerned, Harbans ji has explained you the technical points or the constitutional points, but I will put across something about the Maharaja Hari Singh's mind, which I studied. I had the opportunity. I was in Kashmir. I was a young officer. But later on in 1954, when I was ADC with Dr. Karan Singh, then I went to Bombay and spent 1 month with the Maharaja Hari Singh ji. Then Captain Diwan Singh, his ADC, he was also there. In fact, we both used to stay together for one full month when Her Highness was operated there. So we had nothing much to do, but we used to spend a lot of time with Maharaja Hari Singh ji, who never talked about Kashmir or Abdullah or Nehru. He was something else, the Dogra food, and then he will cook and will talk the makki ki roti, sarson ka saag and all that. But sometimes we try to find out, assess ke 47 mein kya hua, kyun ye nahi hua, accession why it did not take place. So what I deduced from that talk or information I had and later on I gathered, it was like this. As Harbans ji always puts it, Maharaja Hari Singh, his religion was justice. And he always wanted to do what conscience tells and what was right. Probably he thought that 70% were Muslim population and 30% were non-Muslim, and the Hindu, Sikh, Jain, Bodh, and so many caste, religion, subcaste, stretching from Ladakh, Gilgit, Baltistan, very heterogeneous state. In fact, I don't think there is any other state like this, totally three different regions anywhere in the world. So he was not sure what to do, whether if he joins Pakistan, where the 70% population is there. And he also says to the 10% were Shias. Perhaps he felt in his own way that Pakistan has been based on fundamentalism. And if I join Pakistan, 30% Hindus, Sikhs, Jain, Bodh, and even 10% Shia will never be happy in that country. Look at how right he was. Can you ever imagine his foresight? I mean, he had predicted that in an Islamic state, what will happen 170 years later or 60 years later. Pakistan is divided of Hindus and others, no one, 1-2% left. So that was in mind that his subject were a family to him, his children. He said, even if 40% are humiliated there, it's not worth it. Let me think. And on the other hand, he felt that if all the 100, my whole state, I joined India, they will all be comfortable. Even 60% Sunnis will be happy because it is based on democratic pluralism. That was one reason why he was in two minds. And then second thing was, India was never receptive to him. And reasons, of course, you know, they have been discussed. But the real reason I can tell you is this. Real reason was, because now we have observed the Black Day. I'm glad it is being done. And some truth is coming out. Actually, I would say that it is the time now to bring the truth out. The truth has not been spoken. Whether it was state forces, who did the actual fighting, who stopped, that I will come later. But that was the reason. Now, what happened? British never wanted J&K to join India. It was not in the scheme of things. They wanted J&K to be part of Pakistan. And particularly Kashmir and Gilgit and Baltistan, which they had already taken over in 1935. Why did they had taken it to fight Russia. And when Russia became ally in 39 war, why didn't they return it? They kept it. Why? The British are very far-sighted. They planned 50 years. They had thought one day India will have to be divided and we will divide it. And if that comes, Gilgit, we have to keep it as a protectorate or some way. In fact, at one time it was thought that it may not return Gilgit to even anybody. But that didn't happen. And when the war ended in 45, for 2 years they didn't hand over. They had all these plans of giving Gilgit and whole of J&K to Pakistan. And therefore, I would say Mountbatten stayed. Mission with Mountbatten was not only to divide India, but ensure that J&K goes to Pakistan. And for which he did more than anything else. Now you can see even when I will come to the second part later, but that was the reason that Nehru, Mountbatten, before British India government, before 15th August, nobody was prepared to accept Maharaja Hari Singh. But now second part, that when we did not join any dominion, the British thought that Maharaja has not joined and Maharaja can join India sometime. Therefore, the state must be annexed with the Pakistan. And the plan was made by the British. And Frank Meserve, the commander-in-chief of the Pakistan Army, signed the operation order and sent it personally to Brigadier Murray, Commander Kohat Banu Brigade, that this is the operation order, these are the troops allocated, and you will attack on 22nd October, Muzaffarabad. It's given date of operation, what we call D-Day, that is the day of operation, 22nd October 47. When Calcutta opened it, he was surprised. And he rang up his brigade commander who was not there. That's how he opened it, brigade major. The brigade commander tells him, don't speak it out. If you do, you will not go back to India. So he was put under arrest for almost 2 months. Somehow he managed to escape on the 18th of October and reached Delhi and informed Sardar defense minister, and then the and then the this general Kulbant and Usput brigadier the and brigadier also MO. Here is the plan. Sardar Baldev Singh ji, they didn't even inform J&K. They didn't inform even the Mir Chand Mahajan, who was the prime minister at that time. Imagine. And that's how they knew nothing. And other things, what Harbans ji has just told you, that some messages were being intercepted when false. And they were worried what is happening when. And what Pakistan had done from their intelligence department or intelligence directorate, they had taken all the Indian maps to Pakistan. They knew it. The British had organized that there was no map available of J&K. When they were trying to look where Owen is and all that, they wouldn't find. So it was a British plan executed by the British through the Pakistanis. And when it happened, 22nd October actual attack, and we all know in Muzaffarabad, they had decided, in fact, they had been advised even, I would say, by General Scott, that my troops are very, very good. They are war-hardened, 4JAC, one of the best battalions probably in India, who were with General Zorawar Singh's best battalion, who had defeated the Chinese in May 1841 and captured their Mantalai flag. And even that battalion later on, after this, when they went to Sainawala, they knocked off a brigade completely. And this is the only regiment because of 4JAC that today J&K Rifle, the only regiment of any state force, is a permanent regiment and the best regiment today in the Indian Army. Jammu and Kashmir Rifle is number one regiment today. This was the battalion. But because unflinching faith in their Muslim comrades. And what happened? Even people went to Maharaja himself, sent a message. Brigadier Rajinder Singh asked them, Colonel Narayan Singh, that this is not that kind of Japanese war. This is a religious problem. He said, no, I have full faith in my Muslims, more than my own Hindus. And he had to pay for that. That night, while sleeping, all the Hindus were massacred. Their weapons were collected. Dusara hota tha unmein, ye, this unit mein aisa hota tha ke Hindus will take on the duties for Eid days and Muslims will take on duties in the Dusara days. And Dusara was coming next 2 days. Unka, now you go and rest. And their weapons were taken, put in the coat, put a lock, and the key was lost. They didn't have any weapons. They were all killed sleeping without weapons. The terrible treachery they did on us, and nobody talks about it. Why? Because something will happen and somebody will feel. But this is a historical fact. It must be known, particularly the army must know. We must be prepared for all these things. And that is why these people then moved, and India will not believe that attack hua hai. And when they, then of course, the other long story, but Brigadier Rajinder Singh was sent to find out what is happening. They didn't know what was happening. And when with this 100 people, they reached Udi, spent the night at Udi, it was raining, it was hailing, it was very cold, wet. They had nothing because they were never prepared for this war. They had to move within 12 hours. And next morning when they went towards Muzaffarabad, then they saw the 300, 400 vehicles lined up coming, the villages burning. And then some refugees told that this is what happened. They have killed everybody, taken all the women, they are looting. And the 4JNK is guiding them in the leading vehicles. And with difficulty, we have managed to come out. Then they suddenly took position there. In the day, Brigadier Rajinder Singh was leading with Captain Prithi Singh Salathiya, and with Duni Chand Sharma, platoon commander. So they quickly put one platoon on the road, one on the hill. And when Pakistani came, Captain Prithvi Singh with four people attacked the front vehicle, killed the driver, sat down in the vehicle, drove the vehicle. Imagine, this is the Dogras. And the enemy was stunned, they were told, and four Jack, my own boys were leaving, my regiment, Muslims from Punch and all over. And Dunijan's platoon opened fire on the vehicle, thinking Pakistani vehicle is coming straight. They fled, completely knocked the village, the vehicle on the middle of the road. Even Captain Prithvi Singh, who was driving the vehicle, he was wounded. He was evacuated. But luckily, the guard helped us. That vehicle was stuck in the middle of the road. Nothing could pass from right and left. And 300 vehicles were lined up. And we were fixed, and I think 200 people were killed. All vehicles were stopped. And our Narsingdev Jamal, he's alive today. He's the Padma Shri. He's written about 2 dozen books. He was sitting there with Dunijand watching this. So we went there, we saw that. We asked him how it happened. Then he gave the story. And he said, कब तक लड़ते रहे, कहते जब तारे निकले तब जाके उन्होंने वो गाड़ी हटाई, सड़क खुली, फिर वो आगे चले. उसे क्या हुआ, ब्रिगेडियर राजेंद्र सिंह गॉट फुल डे एंड नाइट, देन दे बिकेम वेरी कॉशियस. अदरवाइज दे इफ दिस हैड नॉट हैपेंड, गड़ी बैटल विच इज एज इम्पॉर्टेंट एज आई वुड से द बैटल ऑफ थर्मोपल्ली 480 BC ऑफ ग्रीस. Rajendra Singh went back night, spoke to Maharaj Hari Singh on telephone, told him the whole situation. Maharaj Hari Singh ordered, you go back. Udi must be defended at all costs to the last man, because there is no other alternative. And I'll send you some more troops. Some more troops means about another 20 people with one MMT and one mortar. They arrived. He went back. He blew up the Udi Bridge. And that's how Kashmir was saved. Gadi made us to blow the bridge. And Udi Bridge was blown, which saved our airport for the army to land. And Maharaj Hari Singh to talk for 2 days. But you will be surprised. Then our Mirchand Mahajan asked that, the enemy has come, is knocking at the doors. Nobody would believe him. Imagine, Mirchand Mahajan, who became Chief Justice of India, they won't talk to him. And when he threatened that I am going to talk to Jinnah, then only they said okay, and then Nehru agreed. Otherwise, he too asked Sheikh Saab. Sheikh was sitting there in the room of Nehru and Patel. Then Sheikh said, हाँ हाँ अगर नई आर्मी गई तो कश्मीर खत्म हो जाएगा. तो फिर नेहरू कहता अच्छा हाँ हाँ फौज भेज दो. Then Mountbatten came in and said, no, who says there is danger? होंगे some raiders must be there. That's how they were called raiders. They were not raiders. They didn't come to loot and go back by 1 day or 2 days. They were invaders. वो तो हमलावर थे. और इन पाकिस्तान की आर्मी बीच बैठी थी, कपड़े बदल गए. अभी तो क्लियर हो रहा है कि इट वाज ऑल पाकिस्तान आर्मी. सो दिस इज हाउ देन माउंटबेटन सेड नो, पहले गो एंड फाइंड आउट. ही सेंड बीपी मेनन पोस्ट हेस्ट विद मानेकशॉ एंड दे वर सरप्राइज्ड व्हाट इज हैपनिंग. एंड व्हेन दे सेड गो अहेड देन ही सेड महाराज हरी सिंह आप तो जम्मू जाओ, देन अदरवाइज हु विल साइन इफ समथिंग हैपेंस. बट दैट टू वाज वेरी बैडली टेकन. हाउएवर देन व्हेन ही सेड कि सिचुएशन इज वेरी बैड एंड आर्मी शुड बी सेंट, ही सेड नो. माउंटबेटन सेड नो. माउंटबेटन न्यू एवरी डे कि आज कहाँ पहुंचे हैं. गड़ी हो गया, आज उड़ी हो गया, अभी माहौरा पहुंचे हैं. ठहरो, यू मस्ट रीच श्रीनगर एंड फोर्स द एक्सेशन टू Pakistan, or an accession to Pakistan, if not accession. Then they said, okay, but get the instrument accession. One more day was given. So you see, if on 24th it was decided, and they did not sent B.P. Menon and sent the army on 25th, they would have caught up at Udi. Nothing would have been lost. And even if 25th, make it 26, even 26, they would have made to Mora. Even electricity wouldn't have gone. And that is how this accession took place. This is the story of the accession before 15th August and accession actually on 26th in the evening. Accession was signed, accepted only on 27th, but that night Brigadier Rajinder Singh also got into the ambush and killed. But no vehicle came to Baramulla before 27th morning. And then they say Makbul Sherwani did a lot of things good. We understand. But that all happened with some the raiders, they used to call, then came on foot and he put them on the wrong direction. And then they found it out and they nailed him and fired and killed him. We respect him. We have made his wonderful this memorial, but now somebody is talking Bharat Ratna. We've been trying Bharat Ratna for Brigadier Rajinder Singh. If anybody deserved Bharat Ratna, any soldier in the country, it is Brigadier Rajinder Singh, who saved the state, who was also recognized as the first gallantry award winner of independent India. He is also the first Mahavir Chakra, which should have been Paramvir Chakra, and he was the chief of staff, head of the army of an independent country on that day. And he fought as a ad hoc company commander. And on the night of Mahura battle, he was leading a section with a rifle and fighting in front like a jawan with two people. And for 4 days, they had no food, only living on some bread or some cake from his shop. For 4 days, he fought. And when ultimately he was wounded very badly, he said, "We will take you." He said, "No, my ruler has asked me to defend Uri at all costs. I have been able to only do this much, and I cannot go back. I will be the last man as ordered my ruler." He got the pistol, he said, "Leave me here." And if he had gone, there was another vehicle still coming. He would have picked him up and brought. But he said, "No, it is below my dignity to go back when I am ordered to be the last man to defend Udi. I will die at Udi only." This is how he decided to continue with the pistol in his hand. That is his sacrifice, a Dogra brigadier. How the state is saved. Unfortunately, all these things have not been told. Nobody talks about. And that's why I thought, I welcome this Black Day, that it gives us an opportunity to tell the truth. And that is the truth. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for enlightening us as always and giving us this precious account of history, which, like you very well said, not many talk about or majority of the people don't even know about. This is the irony of modern education system or history, that we don't know much about it. I would like to also call in Mohammed Arif Jakia ji, who has joined us and has been listening us patiently. I would like to get his point of view as well. He is an activist who is currently living in London, but obviously he is from Pakistan, and he's been is actively working in the local government as well, based out of Karachi. So, sir, welcome. And, you know, my first point would be to you, how do you see this whole episode of October 1947 from your perspective? Please give us some idea on it.
First of all, namaste, and thank you very much for inviting me. Happy Dasera to everyone. I was born in Karachi, but I feel more my belonging to Junagadh, where my parents were born, and one way or other, they were obliged to migrate to Pakistan. As Harbans ji and General Saab just now explained to us everything, Pakistan was a design of British. As General Saab said, that it was before 1939 decided that there will be a country and to keep a buffer state for British and international powers, Pakistan, especially Gilgit, as he mentioned. So it was a fabricated country and they did not want to leave India as one India because it had a potential of becoming superpower. So I come from that fabricated country, artificial country, and where we were taught distorted history all the way from childhood till university level, we are taught a distorted history. For example, we are taught that Kashmir was Pakistan and it is occupied illegally by India. We were never taught that Bengalis were butchered and there was a genocide by Pakistan's army of its own people. We were never taught that Balochistan was an independent state on 14 August 1947, which was later on occupied by force by Pakistan. And air bombardment started in Balochistan in early 70s, which is going on even today. The Balochistan operation is going on. Genocide of Baloch people is going on. I left Pakistan in 1984. And later when I came to Europe in 1990, there I started learning the true history. We in Pakistan are called Muhajirs, those who migrated from India to Pakistan. We are facing discrimination all the way in every walk of life. For example, when I completed my matric, I could not get admission in college because I had a quota system which stopped me taking admission in college for government jobs. For everything, we had this discrimination, but living in Pakistan, I never understood that this is a discrimination. But when I came to Europe, then I realized that we did not have any human rights in Pakistan. Then in 1994-1995, a military operation started in Karachi against the Muhajirs. And there the representative party of Muhajirs, MQM, contacted me in Belgium and asked me to work for human rights of Muhajirs and attend human rights sessions in United Nations Geneva to explain the situation of Muhajirs. And when I went to United Nations, the biggest human rights group there was of Kashmiris. And I was surprised and I said that what these Kashmiris are doing here, because Kashmir is Pakistan and India is an occupier. I was sitting in a meeting where there were Kashmiris from both sides, from Pakistan and from India. And there I was told that it was Pakistan, as General Saab explained, that it was more Pakistani army people in civilian dress than the tribals who attacked Jammu and Kashmir, which had an standstill agreement with both India and Pakistan. So Pakistan violated that standstill agreement. Now, if it was for Muslim population, I was told, and which is correct, that thousands of Muslim and non-Muslim women were kidnapped on 22 October from Jammu and Kashmir. And these women were sold in Rawalpindi, in Bada, the Fata area of Pakistan's bazaars. So this is how they were serving the Muslim cause in Kashmir. Then I said that Pakistan always insists that Kashmir solution should be as per United Nations resolutions. So I said, why don't India accept it? And then I was told that the resolution of United Nations asks Pakistan and every Pakistani to leave Jammu and Kashmir first, and then India should conduct a plebiscite. And I was looking at my Pakistani Kashmiris and they kept quiet. So this is the real story, that creation of Pakistan was a British ploy, was a superpower's ploy, superpowers, the victorious forces of Second World War, and especially the Gilgit and POK and Kashmir was a design for a buffer state for superpowers to control China, Russia, and India, because India was always a rich state, rich in wealth also, and rich in history, civilization, wisdom, education. India's heritage is the richest heritage of the world. So this kept a fear in the minds of superpowers. And as General Saab said, that British, they think 50 years ahead for everything. So they decided to keep a buffer state there. And Jammu and Kashmir, as it was said by learned General Saab, that Lord Mountbatten did not allow Indian army to go to Jammu and Kashmir to defend Jammu and Kashmir, because they did not want Jammu and Kashmir to be part of India. So that's what happened. Same thing happened in Junagadh, that my state Junagadh was a predominantly Hindu majority state. So why it had to go to Pakistan? It had to stay peacefully with India. And Jammu and Kashmir, which had a diverse population, because Muslims were not in a majority there, because Muslim, what is the definition of Muslim? Because for a Sunni, Shia is not a Muslim. Ahmadis, who were on forefront in the independence movement of Pakistan, the artificial state, they were declared non-Muslim by Pakistan's constitution in 1974. Shias are called kafir in Pakistan. Jinnah himself, a Shia Isnashari, they don't recognize him as a Shia. They say, no, he was a Sunni, because Shias are kafir. So, of course, Gilgit-Baltistan was majority Shia. Valley was majority Sunni. Ladakh, majority Buddhist. And then the most important part is that there is a legal accession treaty. The legal document about Jammu and Kashmir is the accession treaty. An accession treaty was not only signed by Maharaja, who was not a Muslim. It was signed with the consent of Muslim majority leader Sheikh Abdullah also, because Sheikh Abdullah also wanted Jammu and Kashmir to be part of India. So Jammu and Kashmir, legally, it is part of India. Pakistan is an occupier of POK and Gilgit-Baltistan. Pakistan is an occupier of Balochistan. Pakistan, as Jammu and Kashmir is divided by British, KPK, the Pakhtun belt, was also divided by British with Durand line, drawing two separate states for Pakhtuns, KPK in Pakistan and Afghanistan. Pakhtuns are also not happy with Pakistan. They are facing a military operation. First of all, they were branded as international terrorists during Afghan war. So the terrorists were Pakhtuns, and the ones who were killed were Pakhtuns. It took so many decades to Pakhtun to realize that what is happening to us. So Pakistan is a Punjabistan, which has occupied KPK, Balochistan, Sindh, and POK Gilgit-Baltistan. So it's an artificial state created by superpowers. And I hope that very soon this country will be dismembered, because it has no moral ground to exist. It is a terroristan. It exports only terrorists globally, in particular to the neighboring Afghanistan and Pakistan. Look at Bangladesh. When they were East Pakistan, we used to call that ye bhikari hain, inke paas khane ko nahi hai, ye bhuke nange hain, because everything Bangladesh, East Pakistan produced, we brought to Punjab in Pakistan. Punjab is the most developed region, province of the region, because Punjab gives nothing to Pakistan's national exchequer. Only East Pakistan, Karachi, and Balochistan is giving to national exchequer, but the development is done on Punjab. Look what is happening in Bangladesh. The fastest booming economy of Asia is Bangladesh economy, because they got rid of Punjab. So same thing will happen with Sindhu Desh if it becomes an independent Sindhu Desh, an independent Balochistan. They will develop very fastly. I would more like to listen to my learned colleagues here, because I'm still a student and I'm learning. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Arif sir. Thank you very much for giving us your point of view. It's quite interesting to hear from the other side as well, and you know, get an idea on what your what were you taught about the situation. And this is a very common insight. Like being in London, you know, I come across a lot of people from Pakistan origin who have very little knowledge on the history, especially on the United Nations resolution, where the first condition is for Pakistan to vacate the state of Jammu and Kashmir. But, you know, that is what is not taught in Pakistan. All they have been taught is a plebiscite, which is obviously not possible unless we start with the condition number one. I would like to come back to Harbhajan sir now, because this is again, from my perspective, I think it's very important for us to understand why is this huge gap in education where none of us in our schools were taught about it. Whatever we've learned is out of our own interest, and only those who have interest in the history knows about this particular situation on what happened before 1947, what caused to the this whole incident to take place, and then how it happened, and then whatever has happened or had happened, we are not aware of it. I don't think the current generation back home in India, or the Pakistani generation, or even us people outside India have any knowledge about it. So Harbhajan sir, what do you think can be done or could have been done to preserve that history?
Thank you, Vikrant. But before I answer your question, let me thank and congratulate Arif Bhai. He has brought out very important facts about Pakistan. The most important fact which he talked just now, and which very few people in India are aware of, that Muhammad Ali Jinnah was not only a Shia, but when he died, there were two funeral prayers for him. One funeral prayer was private in his residence according to the Shia ceremonies. And then a public ceremony was held according to the Sunni rituals before he was buried. So this exposes the hollowness of the two-nation theory. Thank you very much, Arif Bhai. It's nice to hear such a thing. Vikrant, to your question, I have struggled all my life. I have written in the introduction of my first book on Kashmir, Maharaja Hari Singh, The Troubled Years, that how as a young boy, I was troubled by the fact that Maharaja Hari Singh was blamed for what happened. And I could never get very good answers, satisfying answers. When I used to come to Samba, I recall very vividly that people during the late 50s, 60s, who had fought the war, they would come, sit, talk, but they were very apologetic. They were apologetic because they were a beaten army. They were the soldiers who could not live up to the high standard that had been left by their ancestors while conquering Ladakh and Gilgit. They had lost the war, and all the blame was on these soldiers. Even today, the Indian Army, if you read the history of the Indian Army regarding the 1947-48 war, there is hardly any credit given to the state army, barring a few places. In fact, even Brigadier Rajendra Singh, I sometimes feel he has been given credit grudgingly. This always troubled me, and I wanted to find answers. I wanted to write, but I couldn't write. And when I tried to defend Maharaja Hari Singh, the problem was I had no evidence, nothing to bank upon and say that not this is the fact and not this, as you people are narrating. It was only in the year 2008 that Dr. Karan Singh released the documents relating to Maharaja Hari Singh. And one of the documents that was released and published in his book, Jammu and Kashmir 49 to 64, correspondence between Karan Singh and Jawaharlal Nehru. In the index of that book, that memorandum of Maharaja Hari Singh to Dr. Rajendra Prasad has been published. That was the first time that we came to know a document came into public domain that these were the reasons. Now, obviously, there is something faulty in our education system if we are not told about these facts. If Jammu is completely ignored. Now, how deeply that impacts, may I point out that even today, as we talk about 22nd of October and not about the invasion in Poonch. My question to all of you is that why is it so? Is it because Kashmir looms very large in our consciousness? Is it because Jammu is insignificant? And because of its insignificance, what was happening to the residents of Poonch? What was happening to the soldiers who were fighting in Poonch? That is irrelevant, that is immaterial. And the whole of the war was fought only in Kashmir, only for saving Srinagar, only for saving that valley. Because remember, even after Indian Army had gone there, we lost vast tracts of land after the arrival of the Indian Army. Indian Army had failed then to recover those lands. No effort was made to either help the garrison in Skardu or after Kargil had been captured to send the forces towards Skardu rather than towards Leh. So these are questions they need to be answer. Now to the your main question that why was it so? I believe it is because of our faulty understanding of secularism as well as the fact that we are a little bit hesitant. We are timid. We are afraid that this might not spoil the whole game of Kashmir. In our mistaken belief, we have allowed things to drag on. And we have hidden the facts of history that Kashmiris should not be offended. For fear of offending the Kashmiris, for fear of pushing them towards the secessionists, we have halted before the whole narrative could be put out. Now, this should have been put out by the state government. The state government, as we know, it was always Kashmir-centric. To be more specific, it was Muslim-centric. I'm sorry to say that. But the first priority was always Kashmiri Muslims, then Kashmir, and finally, if something still remains to be distributed, that would come to Jammu. That has been the history. Now that things have changed, let us hope that at least history is corrected. In this context, let me remind you that Sheikh Abdullah went to the United Nations and he made a speech there. In that speech, he categorically declared that the administration of the state had come to a standstill, the ruler had fled, and we, the people of Kashmir, we were forced to take over and fight our battle against Pakistan. Now, may I point out, as General Saab also just now told, that Maharaja Hari Singh left Srinagar on the express advice of the special secretary to Sardar Patel. On his advice, he had moved to Jammu so that he was available. He does not fall in the hands of the raiders, and he was available if any quick decision needs to be taken. But his administration was very much in Srinagar. The paraphernalia which remains, the officials who remain in Srinagar, they were there because the Darbar move was also about to take place. Advance parties had already left for Jammu. But the whole setup was there. The government had not collapsed. But this narrative was officially circulated by Sheikh Abdullah's government. This narrative became that Maharaja had fled, became a narrative that came to be accepted by everybody. And that is the narrative that was in the history books. That was the narrative which has remained among the political commentators and historians till date. And probably I am the sole voice, sole person who has written that this is a false narrative. It needs to be rejected. I point out that you have a document with you. Why don't you refer back to the document and read it and then decide what are the facts? Nobody has ever heard Maharaja Hari Singh. Even General Govardhan Singh Ji, who stayed there for 4 months, he never heard him talking about Kashmir or Sheikh Abdullah. He never did. That was the only time in that public document that he expressed his views. He gave his reasons. And those reasons cannot be negated because they are facts. So once, if we accept, our history accepts this, that these were the circumstances, that the reason for the delay was this, the complexity, heterogeneity of the state, and the internal struggle, what is the right thing to do? Will it be just to this party? Will it be just to the other party? What will be the fate of the minorities? This was a dilemma. And for that, he wanted time. He never got that. And history, as has been handed over to us, is hanged thereby. Somehow, I believe that now some people in Jammu, at least, they will be working towards this goal of correcting the facts of the past. Unless those facts are corrected, we can never reach a reasoned conclusion. Arif Bhai has given a very detailed history of the provincialism of Pakistan and how one province dominates the others. This state of Pakistan, an unnatural creation, neither geography divides these regions, nor history, nor culture. May I remind everybody, if I have some time, that we call ourselves India. The world calls this land India. This word was given to us by the Greeks. The word was given by Greeks because they reached only up to the Indus River. Indus, the greatest river of the world, because the tributaries which come to it, they have created so many sub-empires, empires and sub-empires. No one can divide culturally Junagadh with Sindh. The culture, the philosophical developments, they are common. So in the name India from Indus, and yet Indus is in Pakistan, much of it, it's only part of it in Ladakh. And yet Pakistan, which got Indus, they opted to name itself as Pakistan and not India. Had they decided that their country will be called India, nobody could have stopped them. If India had adopted the same title, India, then it would have been something else, as we know many countries do it, that the new Republic of India, so and so, and this and that. But Pakistan had every right to call itself India. It did not. It wanted to reject the culture. It wanted to cut away from the umbilical cord. So all these facts about our history past, not just 47, not just the rise of Jinnah and how Pakistan was created, but the cultural history of this region, it's very important that we have a bird's eye view of this history to understand what is going on where. After a long time, I'm hearing somebody talking about these cultures in Junagadh. Arifbhai, thank you very much for that. Because ever since I have read long back a book called The Empires of Indus, written by a young lady, Alice Albinia, I've been fascinated by the cultures of all those states which are somehow connected to Indus. And Junagadh, I must say, it is part of the same land, the same culture. Thank you, Vikrant. I hope I have answered this question, though it's a very volatile subject. And sometimes it's very difficult to keep boundaries between emotions and reason. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you very much. I know it's a very volatile question, and I think we've discussed this many a times in the past, and still I'm glad we have all come together, and hopefully by recording this session, and you know, there are many more others who are talking about these topics and talking about the history. I'm very certain that in coming future there will be more documentation of these events and series of events, and perhaps we'll be able to put it in one notion where everybody can read it and understand what happened in 1947. So once again, I think we've gone beyond our time limit today. So it's more than an hour. I would still like to put up one last point here, which let me just quickly read. Yeah, so you know, we keep on talking about the situation in you know, Kashmir and what happened during those times. One last thing, without, you know, taking too long, in your point of view, what happened during those times in Jammu? Because not many of us talk about what was going on in Jammu during those days. So all we talk about is what was happening in Kashmir and, you know, Uri and all those places. So just give us a very brief answer on that. What do you think was the situation in Jammu at that time?
You are asking me or General Jamwal?
No, sir, yourself, Harbhajan, sir.
Vikrant, let me say that I was born in 1947. So there's no way that I can give you an account of what was happening. But after reading, I can tell you that what happened. The information which I gather from the books, from the memoirs, and there are many of them. Jammu, of course, I have spoken on this subject earlier also. Jammu was by and large peaceful when this invasion took place. The problem began when refugees started coming from Punjab. the refugee problem, that created a problem here. It inflamed passions. And when the Hindu refugees arrived here and they saw that the Muslims were living peacefully in Jammu, their hatred could not be contained. This is how the situation deteriorated, of which Sheikh Abdullah took full advantage in denigrating the Dogras in general and Maharaja Hari Singh in particular. He accused him of instigating these riots. Riots did take place. I don't deny that, because I know for a fact that some of those who had participated in it, I have talked to them. Therefore, I can say with some authority that yes, the riots did take place. The killings of Muslims did take place. It cannot be denied. It's a fact. But the other fact was that Jammu was very peaceful. If we read the book of Parvez Diwan, Jammu, we will find the number of Muslim officials working in Jammu. There's a large number of Muslim officials. In the police department, there were very many officials. In revenue department, there were Muslims. And a balance was maintained between all these communities because justice was even-handed. What do common people need? Common people need good governance. Common people need that people should be able to live peacefully and go about their everyday business without any fear. And that if when there is a grievance, that grievance is addressed in a lawful manner. This they had. I suggest that you look at in the YouTube, there is a video of Justice T.S. Thakur speaking on Maharaja Hari Singh. In that, though he too is not a witness, he is younger to me, but he narrates that he has heard from his elders that once Maharaja Hari Singh was coming to Jammu and a herd of goats and sheep, they had almost stopped the traffic there. The ADC of Maharaja, he lost his patience and he warned that clear the road immediately or I'll shoot. And the Gujjar is supposed to have told him ki tum mujhe maroge, tumko pata hai yahan Maharaja Hari Singh ka raj hai. So this kind of confidence, if a common illiterate man has in the rule of law of that land, that speaks volumes for the kind of society there was at that time. And obviously, when communal passions are aroused, things deteriorate. Humanity becomes subhuman. There is a Pakistani writer, young lady, Anam Zakaria. She has worked a lot on the partition tales of 1947 and the birth of Bangladesh 1971. And she has met the victims on both the sides. And she has come to the conclusion that memories, they depend so much upon the state narrative that you tend to forget what you actually experienced, actually saw, and you start believing in what the state narrative is given to you. This happens to us also, in our context also. But if, like she did, she dug out stories, she talked to people exhaustively, and then gradually she learned that all those who remember the massacre, the violence, and the atrocities of the other community, they also have something good to say. They also have some fond memories of the past when things were good. So humanity needs to focus on that good aspect of life rather than encouraging the baser instincts. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you. With those words of humanity should look at the good side of things as well. I would like to now conclude with final words from Govardhan sir on how he sees, you know, now we're celebrating the accession day. It's no more, we don't want to live with that, those troubled days or the sad phase of life. Sir, how do you now see it, you know, after almost 73 years later, you know, we're celebrating this day. What are your thoughts on it?
Well, this first time after 73 years, things have been talked. What we are talking, it was never talked. And if I tell you that the whole account of what I have told you, and particularly the attack on Muzaffarabad, is written in the Government of India, Ministry of Defense, history, and that is the history of Jammu and Kashmir operations. It was ready in 1965, but was not released till 87. And by that 87, J&K operations had become stale. After that, four major wars had been fought. And I can tell you today, I asked the chief of army staff of the Indian Army just a few days back. I said, have you read this account of the J&K operations published in the Ministry of Defense book? He said, General, I have not seen it. So what the narrative of the government was, not to talk about the Pakistani attack in that form, and certainly not where the Hindu-Muslim clash took place. With the result, what happened? We didn't learn lessons. I know Indira Gandhi, these two Sikh boys who assassinated her, they were posted as guards. And the guard commander, the security officer, came to know after the Blue Star that they should not have been posted there. So he put it on file to the Prime Minister that these two boys have been put without our notice knowledge. So may we change them? She said, no, they will not be changed. And next day, both of them assassinated her, killed her. If we had learned from Muzaffarabad, then probably that would have been codified. All these things would have been taught. I was teaching in the Indian Military Academy as a this very senior instructor. We never touched the subject. In fact, we never taught them what is good for us. We have been still teaching them what the Britishers wanted us to teach. And that was all the wrong end of the history. Indian history has not been taught. And we have been reading only foreign histories or only the Mughal period or those periods which suppressed the Indians, the Hindus. The same thing has happened now. We didn't know about Subhash Chandra Bose much. It's now a little bit we know after Modi ji came. So, as Harbhajan ji said, it is the narrative built by the government. Now, yesterday I was watching the TV, Barkha Datta, I was taking part in that, and General Hasnain was talking, Mattu was talking. Mattu did not speak a word about Brigadier Rajinder Singh, J&K State Forces, 4 days battle, 5 days, 7 days, not a word. And half an hour he said that it was only Maqbool Sherwani who has saved Kashmir. He put them on the wrong direction, and when they came to know, they nailed him and fired and killed him. We respect him. As I said, we have got a beautiful hall. He was a 19-year boy. He didn't know what was happening all over. But the wrong narrative, even now, is being built in a wrong narrative. And the man who deserve Bharat Ratna, even the chiefs present now, they said in a meeting that first Bharat Ratna must go to Brigadier Rajendra Singh. Genuinely, he stayed put as a lost man, as ordered, with the pistol in his hand, and gave his life and saved Kashmir, saved the airport, enabled Maharaj Hari Singh to do the session. What else you want from a man? So I'm glad that now we are talking about it, and I hope it opens up. And once it opens up, with this 370 gone, and the otherwise in my Jammu University, where Mattu was 6 years of this vice chancellor, he never did a thing like this. Dogra history was forgotten. He was finding out what is the cultural what cultural things in Pakistan are common with Jammu. Good. But where is the history? So therefore, now I think if it takes a turn with Black Day celebration, I hope it's a landmark transition from that wrong narratives to come to the real narratives. And I hope the government also follows it, people follow it, and we all follow it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for your words. Right, and I think we should go towards our conclusion now. I will ask upon Nidhi Sharma ji if she can come in. Nidhi Dogra ji, if she can come in and say the final notes.
Well, I don't need to say much. I have to thank everybody for giving us such a great insight. And I must tell you that since Sangeeta Jaitley's phone was not working properly, she's sitting right with me. And we have gone through the whole thing, and which has taken us back to our childhood. Our father has been narrating these stories to us during our growing up periods. So for you all, it must be stories. For us, it was, whenever he had time, he would narrate them to us. So we are not very much unfamiliar with them. In fact, there are many more that we know, probably are not even come in forefront. But right now, since we are running out of time, and I think we will have many more occasions that we can be together, I thank all the speakers, Mr. Major General Jambal and Shri Arif. I think, Mr. Arif, it was great listening to you, and it was very nice that there are people who think across the border like us. And Mr. Samyal, what you have given us the insight today, I think it is something, something very, very, very great. So anyways, I thank all of us. I thank International Dogra Society and the REACH group. And of course, together today, we three people have come together on one platform. And in coming future, we will be many more, because our agenda is one. We should be under one umbrella, and so that we can fight everything properly in the right way. Thanking everyone. Thanks a lot.
Once again, thank you very much, Nidhiji. Thank you everyone for joining us. That would be all for today. We shall meet once again with a new topic, and perhaps we'll learn more about the history of Jammu and Kashmir there. Thank you. Namaste.
Namaste.
Namaste. Namaste.
Thank you so much.